in itself, especially international truck driving, has changed out all of recognition. It's got to such a point now that even eminent people are starting to notice how much it's changed. Because I actually read in the paper the other day, and I quote, truck drivers need the intelligence of cabinet ministers, the technical know-how of first-class engineers, and the agility of top-class bookmakers. And that was by Mr. Jack Jones. Within the business, the haulage business that is, there is a great deal of emphasis upon status. The worst you can have is driving general haulage, where you have to, big tilt trailer, we have to throw the sheet up, get filthy, dirty. Next up from him, tanker driver. Good job. But the absolute ultimate is what I drive. And that's a container, because the only work that I do physically involving the trailer itself is undoing four twist locks. They're big bars which actually fix the container onto the trailer itself. Makes my work very easy. So, I suppose virtually you could be called the king of the road driving this sort of thing. I was actually under the impression that when we joined the common market that we were going to have less paperwork to use when we travelled into the common market countries. But contrary to that, the paperwork in actual fact has increased. We now have about 15 pieces of paper that I require to take a load from here to Italy. Delivery notes, consignment notes, all the sorts of bits and pieces of paper that you would probably throw away if you ever had the opportunity.
But listen, I've left you a blank one in there for the trip on the way back. Okay. There's no sweat on that one.
What's in the box?
It's a load of furniture that's going out to Doha in a Middle East.
What the hell's Doha?
Doha store, and it's one of the United Arab Emirates.
LMD 649P. Chiefel?
Okay.
I prefer, as an independent haulier, to use an independent shipping company to cross to the continent with. The reason I choose these independent companies is basically because I have a free meal. I also have a free cabin, which is equal to anything that a holidaymaker would have to pay for. Admittedly, that I already pay for this in some way within the cost of my vehicle, owing to the fact that it costs me somewhere in the region of £260 to £300 to travel on one of these ferries on a return trip.
Morning.
Good morning, sir.
McCangus.
Right. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. For the back of the line. Food fare through there, and the cabin is down below.
Cheers. I'd like £220 in French francs, please, and whatever you've got in Italian lira. I don't have a license to carry large amounts of money out, although you actually need one. It's a case of ducking and diving again to avoid the necessary powers to be down at whichever port it is I travel out from. But I want to sell my money, because that's what I'm doing with it, at the best rate of return, so that I can buy my lira and my francs at a very reasonable rate, and so I don't lose as much money on it. Because after all, I think it's me, it's my money, I'm the one that should make the profit off it, not some bloody bank. Thank you very much. Now, I don't smoke and I don't drink very much, but later on this trip I'm going to need these. The reason that I'm using Felixstowe, Zeebrugge, as a crossing point is that Belgium doesn't require permits, and so this means that the Ministry of Transport are not likely to be at Felixstowe docks asking to see my permit, which are green pieces of paper that are necessary for me to travel across borders so that I can cross freely from the French to the Italian border or France to Belgium as such, and these are a big hassle to me because I have great difficulty in getting them. It also means that the French border, which I'm going to cross at, which is a small border called Dunkirk, the customs people there aren't quite so conversant with the documentation, so that it means that I have a possible chance of actually avoiding having my permit stamped. We're just about to run into the back of a car. Well, some of these Belgian drivers. Well, we've just left Zeebrugge. Now heading down towards Ostend, Belgium. Pass through Ostend, then we travel down to the coast, to Dunkirk, which is in France. France, I have to clear some of my customs for the French papers. From then we take the autoroute down to Lille, from Lille down to Paris. Paris we head south on the autoroute 6. We leave the autoroute at Lyon, where we go across country, where we climb Mont Blanc. Over the top of Mont Blanc, across the top of the boot, to Milan, Padova, Venice, and on to Trieste, where I make arrangements to have the container unloaded, the transshipment on to the Middle East. Takes us over the top of one of the locks in Ostend, and you'll be able to see the bows of the Vindictive. Now the Vindictive was a ship, as I understand it, that rammed the dock gates, would stop them opening or closing during the last war, and the Belgians took the remains of the bows and kept them, and they're there as a war memorial. Drivers have to be very, very professional these days, owner drivers especially, because the cost of their vehicles are fantastic. The particular outfit that I drive costs about £25,000, that's for the tractor and the trailer. The values of the loads vary from a few pounds to thousands of pounds. In actual fact, my load is valued at about £50,000. A lot of people wonder what TIR stands for on a vehicle. Well, TIR stands for Transport International Routier. And this means that the container or the vehicle involved has been sealed by the customs in the UK or from whichever country it's come from, and is now not to be interfered with by the customs until it arrives at its destination. Well, we're now approaching the first of my little problems. We're now about to enter France. The whole object is that when I arrive at the French customs, he will want to stamp my permit. And if possible, I want to try and persuade him not to. Because it's very important to me. If he doesn't stamp the permit, it means that I can use it again for another voyage. Also, I have a problem with the French customs because they limit the amount of diesel which I can bring into the country. Now the permit itself is divided into two sheets, one actually being green, which is the permit itself, and one on the back, which is stapled to it, is the white copy. Now I want him just to stamp the white copy. It's the green copy on the front which mustn't be stamped, because as far as I'm concerned, on arrival back to England, I can just roll it up the ball and throw it away because it's no good for me anymore.
Hello, sir.
Six
pour la maman.
Three. Six
pour
Italy, la France.
Camion.
One pussy. Six pour. Thank you very much, sir.
No, no, no.
Half a coffee.
No.
Okay.
Alors, j'ai... Vous les faites maintenant?
Si. Okay. Merci, chef. Thank you.
Vous faites ensemble?
I see. No, 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 no. For car.
Ah,
for automobile.
Le camion? Oui, oui. Oui, c'est bon, le camion.
Permit stamp. That means I can use it again in France. You never come outside and dip the fuel tank. So in actual fact, I had 400 litres, and I'm only supposed to have 100 litres when I come in. So all in all, the first part of my problems in France have been a very happy one. Drivers themselves aren't treated with the respect that they deserve, basically because the public has a preconceived vision of a truck driver being about 5 foot, the hairs all over them, with a rolled cigarette in the corner of his mouth and greasy bacon stains down the front of his shirt. It's a totally wrong image. They just aren't like that. I think that the truck driver today is invariably professionalism. I'm not saying that you should have Bob McAngus HGV1 behind the name, but I do feel that you should be given credit for driving a very, very difficult beast. Which way are you going? Other block? What kind of go for the...
Because you've got the archway. Put a caravan, you've got to go through the middle. No, nothing can come in the other end. You have to close it so you can go 100 through. £100?
Which is Italian,
isn't it? £100 a stroke to close the house. Gone up here this morning.
What's that?
Italian, right?
Yeah.
Italian, it's got Italian plates on it. Trailers here and the unit's there. Sort of rode over the top of the unit.
As I come by and there's a big cloud of smoke coming out from underneath his trailer,
yeah,
and his bike's all locked on.
Yeah.
I didn't stop, I was motoring too quick and there was a lot of traffic, otherwise I'd have pulled in for it.
You can see about that much the front of the cab and his back wheel and the rest of the trailer sort of sitting on top of it, the landing legs are through the roof.
The reason that I use Burrells is because they have lots of facilities which I need. Telex facilities so that I can contact home, a telephone line which is directly to the UK or to Italy, it all depends which way I'm going. And because the facilities that they have to offer are far better than the places like the Blue Boar or Hilton Service. I want to wash in a clean bowl, and I want fresh hot water to wash in. You don't get that in an English service station.
Thank you.
this is Paris. And this is a periphery we're on at the moment. Normally, just as I arrive here, on the radio, I get a broadcast from Terry Wogan or Jimmy Young or somebody to that on the BBC, telling me that there's heavy traffic at Watford. I really and truthfully think that I should do with a couple of days going around the periphery with me, having a look at some of this stuff.
I don't think we could play rounders, let alone cricket. Is that an English car over there?
Yeah.
I tell you what though, the blonde that's with him's quite nice. You go and see if you can fix the car and I'll take care of the girl, alright? Can we help you at all? Got some water? You got enough? Where?
Port d'Orléans, yes. Just follow the road round and you'll pick up the sign.
Okay.
It's about 5 or 6 k's. Okay?
Thank you.
Alright. Bye.
Well, that was the blonde I was talking about. Drivers develop quite a rapport with their vehicles. In actual fact, I think we're crazy half the time because we actually talk to the vehicles and try to develop a little bit of sympathy with them. When you're going up a long hill, one always talks to the vehicle to try and encourage the best sort of performance out of it. And when the snow's deep on the ground lying all around you, you invariably speak kind words to it so that the thing will start. Drivers also, because they're very masculine, tend to call their trucks by very, very feminine names. My vehicle is called Lady Diana, because my wife is called Diana and I like to think that she's a lady. Because the drivers that actually drive on the continent are quite a small fraternity, they're known by very personal names, or nicknames. Harry the Hat, Egg on Legs. Another one which springs to mind is a chap called Grocer Billy. He was so fat that the bottom of his stomach used to go underneath the steering wheel and the top of his stomach used to hang over the top of it. So you can just imagine how that made it for passing the wheel through the palms of your hands. I've got a nickname. Well, I've got two in actual fact. All depends how long people have known me over the years since I've been doing this game. It used to be Roadrunner because every time I used to overtake people, because I've always had a powerful truck and the big engine, I used to go by and go, boop. You know what the Roadrunner does on the television? Beep, 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 beep. The name stuck. Now it's Super Tramp. Because tramping is a haulage expression, it's to go long journeys and pick up big loads. Well, now with
the... Most international truck drivers are members of the Les Routiers organisation, which is a club or a society that was formed a few years ago. I have a very good choice of meals, and I pay exactly half of what Mr. Average Frenchman pays for his meal. They also have a backup system so that if I break down in France, they'll send somebody out to repatriate the truck. And also, if I have an accident, and God forbid that I ever do, is that they will provide a legal representative that speaks the language of the country, because it's not only France, but it's all of the common market countries.
Personally, I think there's another tasty dish at the table, actually. Far more tasty than this.
Well, so far, you've heard lots about permits. I expect you're wondering what a permit is. Well, that's a permit. That's an authorization to drive in a foreign country for hire, for reward. It means that I, as a British haulier, can accept work to go to places like France and Italy and Germany. Now each of these countries have their own allocation of permits that they give us. They're never enough, and in actual fact they're always too few. For instance, I think last year for Italy there was only 4,500 permits issued. Well, this is a nonsense, because the work to go to Italy is tremendous and the work back to Italy is tremendous. So we need more permits. I, as an owner-driver, get an allocation of 8 permits. To make my business pay, I need 44 permits. So as you can see, that 8 permits a year just does not equate with the sort of business that I want to do. Basic cost of a permit from the Ministry of Transport is only about £2.10 for administration charges. But you can actually buy on the open market in England forge permits. Now this is a forge permit. Now these permits can be brought for the cost of about 30 and even more pounds. The big problem is that while it's all illegal, it's only a man trying to do his business and trying to work. There's plenty of work, plenty of haulage companies to do the business, but no permits to do the work. It's like asking a carpenter to go to work without any nails and a hammer.
Every time I arrive at Macon, which is the town that we're just arriving at now, I remember the time that I broke down in my Volvo that I used to own, on the bridge. Now the bridge is the main road from France to Italy and Switzerland, and I totally blocked the road. It meant that no traffic had come from Italy and Switzerland, and no traffic had come from France to go to Italy. I was stuck there for 4 hours.
Problems that I can imagine most people think that I suffer from is loneliness. Well, contrary to that, I don't suffer from loneliness because I have all the aids that make for the same as you have at home. Like two French birds driving down the automobile waving at me at the moment.
How far do you travel today?
Where
do you live in?
Lille.
Oh. 1 week ago, I drive through Lille. I come from Dunkirk.
Yeah.
Very good. Very lovely town.
Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with Lille?
What?
What is the matter?
No, it's the... Yeah, more than the weather is bad.
The weather?
Bad.
It's the same for me.
As I was saying, loneliness, that's like what you don't really suffer from, because I have all the facilities you have at home, things like a cassette player. In actual fact, most of the time that I drive this truck, it seems to be like a discotheque in here. And also like a bloody factory when them Fiat trucks are about.
Now
truck is 14 litres. Now that means that each cylinder is about 200 or 300 cc bigger than the average car. And each cylinder, I've got six cylinders and they're all in line. On top of that, I've got a turbocharger, which increases the horsepower and develops it, in this case, up to 310 horsepower. Now in Mr. Average's car, he's only got four gears. But I've got 13 gears that I can change and 13 selections that I can make to make me climb up the sides of mountains and drive down autostraders at speed 65-70 miles an hour. Of course, with all the horsepower, you need a large tank to carry your fuel. In this case, the truck runs on diesel. I've got a 100-gallon fuel tank, and this particular vehicle does about 6.5 to 7, so it gives me an average range between fill-ups of about 600 miles. I have several types of brakes on my vehicle. I have the conventional foot brake. I also have an exhauster brake. I have a button down by my heel which I can actually push down, and this restricts the amount of gas that escapes from the engine, that's the exhaust gas. So I can just use this solely as a means of slowing the vehicle down. In the case of my truck, I have, those bits are really noisy, I have windscreen washer on the headlamp for wiper, which actually cleans the lens of the light. The truck itself, as you've probably gathered by now, is my home. When I initially started to do continental work, I didn't even have a sleeper cab, and a sleeper cab is in actual fact what this is called. My bed is a good meter wide, so I'm lucky to talk the wife into going with me, we can both lie in the same bunk. The place I'm going to stop at tonight is called the Bakehouse. That's not its correct name in actual fact, it's just a name used by British truck drivers, probably because we can't pronounce the French name for it. The reason it's called the Bakehouse is because it's the local bakery.
Where are you going?
We're up Trieste.
Yeah. I just come from there.
In Trieste itself?
Give him up. You'll give her the arm and needle. Did you hear about the Kilmer phone?
Tanker driver.
What are you?
I don't know. 150 yards away from the payage. And of course all the lorries were stopping.
Yeah.
And this fella carried on, fell asleep. Yeah. Asleep in the his cab.
Yeah.
Well, less than 2 feet deep.
No, the Dutchman fell asleep when he called me. George Jones come down the man, that was about 10 minutes behind. Three cones come down the other side of the road, hit the Dutchman, the cab was about as flat as that.
The other interesting thing about it is, can you imagine if that lorry hadn't been in front of the tanker? It would have taken a couple of payards, 12 booths with it as well.
Oh, pretty heavy, Labour.
Eh?
We'll have pay nothing then, will we? About 3 weeks ago, one of the two come down the hill and demolished the pay houses. Didn't
have pay though, 2 months ago. I come all the way up from Marseille, right the way through, got up there, took out about 200 banks of pay, and it's empty. And it's a French police and says, I've all seen them all, oh, tremendous, love all of that. I've all got the play coming down.
Yeah.
It cost me money to Dunkirk Gordon, and when I go through the Mont Blanc Aosta or South Bend, it'll cost me money again. Only because I don't want the permit stamped.
Yeah, but you can go. The reason you don't want the stamp is because the French permits, which are issued in France, aren't getting issued in England.
You said to me, well, I'll come in here, you've got a permit, you've got to use it for 4 months.
There are such happens in England.
Oh, yeah.
It's the same in Ventimiglia. And where's the worst place in Ventimiglia for backhandlers?
I don't know.
Saturday I drove down from Holland. Got down here late on Saturday night, rather tired. And I came in here having a meal. Got introduced to a couple. I knew the husband already.
and they got married on the Thursday, and he's got an F-86, a wanker, rubbish, newly married, on one bed.
In the direction of Mont Blanc. In a minute we start to climb the Sedon, which is a very big climb. We start to make the final climb up towards Mont Blanc and leaving France and entering into Italy. Point of interest on the way though is the Sedon itself. The Sedon is a small village at virtually the foothills of the Alps, the last war, the Allies parachuted a woman spy or agent resistance worker into a village, and the Germans, the SS, they got to hear about it, and they asked the village to hand the woman over. But the villagers, true French resistance people, said no way. So the Germans gave them an ultimatum. Either the woman had to be surrendered, or they would take every woman out of the village and put her to the gun. Well, the villagers were very true to their word and said, no, we're not going to tell you where she is. So they took 40 women out of the village, lined them up against the wall and shot them. And very shortly we'll be passing right by the point where the 40 graves are, and the French have now raised a beautiful statue to the good women of the Sedon.
The tunnel that we're just about to enter is called Mont Blanc. Now this is the tunnel that was built in 1965 and is one of the longest tunnels in the world. It's also one of the dearest bloody tunnels in the world for me, because it cost me somewhere in the region of 240 francs to travel through this tunnel. But unfortunately I'm left with very little choice. I only have two other places that I can travel through. One being Ventimiglia, which is down on the south coast by the Mediterranean, and the other is Mont-Cenis, which is only open for 3 months of the year. So one could call it a monopoly.
Now from Mont Blanc, and we're now in Italy. We're just about to arrive, in actual fact, at the Aosta customs post. The first man that you're likely to see will be an Italian policeman. They can be best described as unpredictable.
Hey. Amigo.
Authorization, si?
Hey.
The little demonstration that you've just seen was because the policeman wasn't very keen on having a film camera inside the customs area. I had to go back and shake his hand many times, smile fondly at him. But once we were inside the compound, things changed. So I think the majority remember seeing these cigarettes before. These are the ones that I bought on the boat coming over to Zeebrugge. The prime object of these is so I can go in and give them to the customs man, and so that he doesn't stamp my permit, which, as I explained before, is imperative that I don't get a stamp on the front of, because this means that I can use the permit again. And if I'm lucky, again and again and again and again and again, until finally somebody is in there that's incorruptible. It'll probably be the Pope. Yes, moment.
Cosa la messa?
Furniture.
Ubiel.
Make this job more pleasurable than working in the UK. It's the complete independence, the escapism, if you like. The chance to get away, make your own decisions, be self-reliant, look after yourself. Not have the boss or the chap that you're pulling for breathing down your neck all the time. Seeing fantastic ranges of hills, beautiful fields of fruit, beautiful weather. Sun doesn't always shine like this, like you. Get tremendous rainstorms, and in the winter time, the snow is like you've not seen in England for years. You have great difficulty getting up some of the mountain passes. But all in all, this job is fantastic. I've moaned about the ministry, I've moaned about the customs. I don't physically moan about the job. The job itself is superb. episode with Peterson back half a mile up the road. The reason that he fined me was the fact that there's no heavy lorries permitted on this particular stretch of road. But the piece of road that they send you on takes you somewhere nearly 40 to 50 k's out of your way. And in actual fact, I want to be at the bottom of this road. So I have to go 50 miles right the way around through the country to arrive back at the place. This is the end of the journey for this container, as far as I'm concerned, because this is Trieste. Trieste is my favourite Italian seaside port. It's one of the oldest and one of the most beautiful ports in the whole of Italy. Well, this is where the container and I part company. The container and its load of furniture to go onto a ship and onwards to Qatar, which is in the Middle East, and myself to reload with a container full up with fridges bound for a destination in England. To run my business efficiently, it's very important for me to have organised a return load back to England. In this case, as I've already said, fridges. Because there's no profit in running back to England container. Money is very important to me. I have to make a profit because in 2 years' time I want to buy another vehicle. Because by then this vehicle has 100,000 miles. Present day prices, they cost in the region of £18,000. So costing is vitally important to me. could I get? UK to Trieste, Trieste back to London. It varies between £1,100 and £1,200. That's for a trip. So out of that, you've got to take £2,500 to £300 for ferry crossing. You take about £300, maybe £350 for diesel and road tolls. Take my wages, which are about £80 a week. I then have to see payments on the truck, which is £100 a week. I have insurance to find, which costs me £1,500 a year. I have road tax, which is £720 a year. I suppose out of about £1,100, I have an expenditure of maybe £800 or £900. Sure, I have profit, but you know, that's what I'm in business for. Sure, it's cutting, but I'm away from home a long time. Amongst the bad things, there are far more good things which outweigh it in my mind. And that's the most important thing of all, as long as I'm happy with the job. Mark you, the way legislation's going and the rules and regulations that they're bringing in, I sometimes wonder if I should be doing it in 3 or 4 years' time.